What is the normal file hierarchy in Windows? Hi everyone, Leo Notenboom here for askleo.com. Honestly, a really interesting question that I've been meaning to get around to from a couple of different aspects for some time. What is the normal file hierarchy in Windows 10 or 11? I have Win 10 and have gone through a few hard drives and system crash slash reboots over the years and have multiple user files created by techs. I'm trying to get things cleaned up and organized, but I'm having a difficult time knowing what is where and where it should be. Honestly, the file system, the setup is surprisingly simple in concept. In practice, unfortunately, applications, including Windows itself, often conspire to make it more confusing, perhaps more confusing than it needs to be. So let's take a walk down the standard structure of files and folders and stuff that Windows assumes, encourages, and in some cases, enforces. But before we do that, I want to make sure that we've got a common understanding of some terminologies and some concepts. Drives, folders, and files. I'm going to fire up Windows File Explorer here in Windows 11 so that we can have this discussion and I can show you what I'm talking about as I go through. Drives, also known as volumes or partitions, generally represent physical disk drives of some sort. They can be the hard disk in your machine, HDD or SSD, it doesn't matter. Parts of a hard drive, partitions. Attached USB thumb drives, network-connected drives, and more. Each drive typically represents a different physical entity. So, for example, in my Windows 11 machine here, I have a local disk, C. I have a second drive, D. I actually have a DVD drive, a virtual DVD drive on this machine. I've got yet another drive, drive F. And then I've got this network connection that is drive P. Each of those represents something physically different from one another. As you can see, drives are most commonly referred to by letters of the alphabet, followed by a colon. The most common, that I'm almost positive is going to be on your machine, is C colon, the system drive. It's often the only drive on your system. Drives can contain folders and files. So that means we need to talk about folders. I'm going to go ahead and open up my disk C here, and we can see what's inside. Folders are a way of organizing the data stored on a drive. The metaphor is that of an old-style paper file folder into which you might place documents. On your computer, folders can contain other folders, and in fact, if you've ever used paper folders, you've probably put folders within folders for whatever reason. Folders have names, not unlike what we might have written on the tab on a paper folder, to identify its contents. So here in my disk C, I've got a collection of folders. You can see they have some interesting names: inetpub, mystuff, perflogs, program files x86, users and windows are very common folders to find at the top of your C drive. Files, well, those are your actual data. I open up one of these folders. Here in this folder called T, I have a file called example.foo. Files are given names to indicate what it is they contain. The characters after the last period in a file's name are called its extension and indicate what type of data the file contains. .foo actually has no definition. It's an example file I was using for something else. But you'll see files that commonly end in .jpg, which indicates that it's a JPEG encoded image, or .docx, a Microsoft Word formatted document. There are thousands and thousands of different file types, but they're all just that. Data collected on disk and organized into a single entity, a file. Okay, with disks and folders and files out of the way, now we need to talk about how we keep track of it all. One of the models that is used often is that of a tree. You can see this when you lay it out in Windows File Explorer. If I go over here on the right-hand side and expand this PC, you'll see that I now have C and D and F and P, the four drives on this system. This PC is kind of like the base of our tree. Now, if I expand one of these branches, say the C drive, Then all of a sudden, its contents appear. Each folder on the tree can be expanded in this way. You can see that disk C contains a number of folders. These folders themselves can contain other folders. Those folders can contain files. Eventually, if you go down far enough in this tree structure, you will end up with a folder that either has nothing in it or a folder that has only files. Most importantly, it will have no more folders within it. When you think about it, especially when you expand other folders, essentially branches out into this tree kind of structure. The files that we find in the various places, you might consider to be the leaves in the tree. All of the folders that got you there are kind of sort of the branches. Now, all of what we've seen here in Windows File Explorer is handy when we're navigating around. It's a great graphical way to conceptualize how your files are organized and how to locate them. But honestly, it's cumbersome when you're typing or otherwise referencing a single specific folder or file on your computer. Instead, we use what's called path or tree notation. It's built like this. We take the drive letter, follow it by a colon. We then include each folder that got us to that file, and then finally the name of the file. Each of those elements is separated by a backslash. So if we take a look at these files that I'm looking at right now, it's in C, the drive, My Stuff, Documents, and here's a couple of example file names, test.pdf. If we click up here, we can see that this gets turned into the notation that I'm talking about. C colon backslash folder, my stuff in this case, backslash documents, the next folder that got us to our file. And then to fully reference the file, we would say something like test.pdf. And that is a complete canonical path to a specific file on this computer. You know which drive it is, which folder and subfolders it's in, and the actual name of the file. Okay, with all of that out of the way, we can finally start to answer some of the questions about what a normal hierarchy is in Windows. As we've seen, Windows installs by default to drive C. It can be changed, but it's extremely rare. Windows creates at least the following folders. There may be others, but these are the ones that I think are probably the most common, most important. You can see them here. Program files, which contains installed programs. Program files x86, more installed programs. Users, these are files associated with the user accounts on the machine. We'll get into this in a little bit more detail in a second. And then, of course, Windows. These are the files that make up Windows itself. If you take a look inside of Windows, which I'll just do by double-clicking, you'll see that there are a lot of files and folders already here, including the very commonly referenced System32. But it's C colon users where we really want to spend our time, because that's where our files go. So if I double-click on users, I've opened it up, and I'm looking at the contents of the users folder. Now, this machine has two login accounts, LNote, which is the first five characters of the email address associated with the Microsoft account that I used to sign into this machine. The other account is LEON, Leon. That's a local machine account. But these two names identify a login account on this machine. The other folders are used by Windows for, well, a variety of purposes. You'll see public here, which essentially is a folder that is used to allow different users on the same machine to share things with one another. The LNote account, for example, cannot access what's inside of the Leon account. It's basic security. You have different accounts, and they have their stuff separate from one another. But both of those accounts can access what's placed in the public folders. You may also see a default folder at this point that's normally hidden by default, and it contains essentially a template of what gets put into a new user account whenever it's created. Now, I will often refer to your login ID, this LNote or this Leon, as %username%, which, if you use it literally, is replaced by Windows with your current username. So, if I now type into the address bar here, %usernames%, and I hit enter, I've now gone into the LNote user folder, because that's the account I'm currently signed in as. All right, this folder, the account folder, is sometimes referred to as your home folder. And you'll see a long list of files and folders that are unique to your specific login account. Here you can see I have a bunch of folders that I've created, something called Anything But OneDrive. But the standard folders that you probably recognize are here as well. Your desktop is here. Your documents are here. Your downloads are here. Your music is here. Pictures are here. And of course, if I scroll down, there's videos. Now, there may also be other folders that have been created by some of the software that you've installed. I don't have any good examples on this machine, but you can see that on your own. There may be other folders here that actually are unrelated to Windows, but are related to the programs that you've installed and run yourself. Now, there is one folder here that is missing in this example, and that is OneDrive. If you're using OneDrive, you will find a folder here in your users username folder called OneDrive. That's the folder that contains all of the files that you have stored in OneDrive that are present on your machine. On this specific machine, I happen to have uninstalled OneDrive and removed that folder. When I talk about your standard or default folders, it's these folders that I'm talking about. Documents, downloads, music, pictures, and videos. Each of those has a specific location in your specific user home folder. Now, that's about where any standard organization or hierarchy ends. It's completely up to you how you would then organize the information within each of those folders. Some programs you use may have ideas of their own, but that's not a Windows standard as much as it is a particular program deciding on how it wants to keep its data organized in your folders. So if you like to play around in documents, well, I don't have anything in documents right now because I tend not to use it. But the point is, if you're playing around in documents, you can put whatever you want in there, however you want it to be organized. Now, one really common source of confusion is Windows itself trying to be helpful, essentially by hiding everything I've just talked about. Now, I had to switch users because I tend to customize what's in Windows File Explorer a lot. What we're looking at is another user account, the LEON account on the same machine, and it has its default Windows File Explorer layout. If I expand this a little bit, you'll see that it has all of these quick access shortcuts. The shortcuts completely obscure exactly where these folders live on the disk. This says desktop. It's stored locally. If I double click on it, it goes to desktop and there's nothing here. And there's no indication of where desktop is. Same thing with downloads. There's no indication of where downloads lives. These shortcuts exist because most of the time, you don't really need to know or care where exactly these folders happen to be on your hard disk. The shortcuts are also updated to be correct for the currently signed in user. I'm signed in as Leon right now, so my downloads folder, I can actually explore where that is by looking at its properties. You'll see that it says its location is in C:\usersLeon. If I had been signed in as LNote, then this would have said C:\usersLNote, a completely separate user-specific downloads folder. All right. Like I said, that's about as close to a standard hierarchy as you might expect out of Windows. A lot of what's left is ultimately up to you. There is one more folder that we need to talk about. In theory, you should never, ever need to know or care about this folder, and yet it keeps coming up again and again. If I go to home, you can see that that is just home. That doesn't tell me anything. So what I really need to do is go to c:\users/leon, which is the current users home folder. Now it actually looks like files and folders. I'm going to switch to detailed views so that we can see the whole list. And there it is. This is the folder I'm talking about, app data. If you don't see it, if you go here and you don't see it, you may need to go to the view menu, show, and show hidden items. So I've got hidden items turned on this machine. In older versions of Windows, you may need to go to the options dialog, and in the view, you'll see that here, hidden files and folders are also shown. This is the old way of doing it. They made it easier in Windows 11. But anyway, we have app data. We'll double click on it, and there's some interesting folders there. There's some confusing folders there. App data, like I said, is hidden by default. In theory, you should never have to see it. The intent is that the programs running on your machine, aka apps, store their data within this folder. That means that each user of your computer has its own collection of data separate from other users. There's generally a very, very deep and complex collection of folders and subfolders depending on what you've got installed on this machine. On my primary machine, I have over 100,000 folders and 250,000 files. Yeah, that machine has a lot installed. The most common question, of course, is what's the deal with local, local low, and roaming? Well, roaming is intended to be data that gets synchronized across machines in a corporate environment where users can move from machine to machine. So I might log into this machine as Leon, and I might log into a different machine in the same company, the same corporation as Leon. And in theory, the data that shows up in the roaming folder would be the same and be automatically replicated. Local, well, as you might expect, local data stays local to this machine. And local low, which actually was new to me when I was researching this, apparently this one's intended for applications that have low trust and run with limited permissions. It's also local to the machine only. All of that honestly doesn't matter. The reality of the situation is that applications tend to be very inconsistent about which one they use. And the good news is that for most of us at home or in small businesses, the distinction really doesn't matter. So hopefully you now have a better understanding of what the whole Windows default or standard file and folder structure is all about. Depending on your needs, you can simply use the layout as it happens, or you can set up your own hierarchy somewhere else as you see fit. For updates, for comments, for links related to this topic and more, visit askleo.com/184027. I'm Leo Notenboom, and this is askleo.com. Thanks for watching.